Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Myth of Race, The Troubling Persistence of an Unscientific Idea, by Robert Wald Sussman, narrated by David Colacci. Introduction. In 1950, UNESCO issued a statement asserting that all humans belong to the same species and that race is not a biological reality but a myth. This was a summary of the findings of an international panel of anthropologists, geneticists, sociologists, and psychologists. A great deal of evidence had accumulated by that time to support this conclusion, and the scientists involved were those who were conducting research and were most knowledgeable about the topic of human variation. Since that time, similar statements have been published by the American Anthropological Association and the American Association of Physical Anthropologists, and an enormous amount of modern scientific data has been gathered to justify this conclusion. Today, the vast majority of those involved in research on human variation would agree that biological races do not exist among humans. Among those who study the subject, who use and accept modern scientific techniques and logic, this scientific fact is as valid and true as the fact that the Earth is round and revolves around the sun. Yet as recently as 2010, highly acclaimed journalist Guy Harrison, 2010, wrote, "One day in the 1980s, I sat in the front row in my first undergraduate anthropology class, eager to learn more about this bizarre and fascinating species I was born into. But I got more than I expected that day as I heard for the first time that biological races are not real. After hearing several perfectly sensible reasons why vast biological categories don't work very well, I started to feel betrayed by my society. Why am I just hearing this now? Why didn't somebody tell me this in elementary school? I never should have made it through 12 years of schooling before entering a university without ever hearing the important news that most anthropologists reject the concept of biological races." The Myth of Human Racism. Unfortunately, along with the belief in the reality of biologically based human races, racism still abounds in the United States and Western Europe. How can this be when there is so much scientific evidence against it? Most educated people would accept the facts that the Earth is not flat and that it revolves around the sun. However, it is much more difficult for them to accept modern science concerning human variation. Why is this so? It seems that the belief in human races, carrying along with it the prejudice and hatred of racism, is so embedded in our culture and has been an integral part of our worldview for so long that many of us assume that it just must be true. Racism is part of our everyday lives. Where you live, where you go to school, your job, your profession, who you interact with, how people interact with you, your treatment in the healthcare and justice systems are all affected by your race. For the past 500 years, people have been taught how to interpret and understand racism. We have been told that there are very specific things that relate to race, such as intelligence, sexual behavior, birth rates, infant care, work ethics and abilities, personal restraint, lifespan, law-abidingness, aggression, altruism, economic and business practices, family cohesion, and even brain size. We have learned that races are structured in a hierarchical order and that some races are better than others. Even if you are not a racist, your life is affected by this ordered structure. We are born into a racist society. What many people do not realize is that this racial structure is not based on reality. Anthropologists have shown for many years now that there is no biological reality to human race. There are no major complex behaviors that directly correlate with what might be considered human racial characteristics. There is no inherent relationship between intelligence, law-abidingness, or economic practices and race, just as there is no relationship between nose size, height, blood group, or skin color, and any set of complex human behaviors. However, over the past 500 years, we have been taught by an informal, mutually reinforcing consortium of intellectuals, politicians, statesmen, business and economic leaders, and their books, that human racial biology is real and that certain races are biologically better than others. These teachings have led to major injustices to Jews and non-Christians during the Spanish Inquisition, to blacks, Native Americans, and others during colonial times, to African Americans during slavery and Reconstruction, to Jews and other Europeans during the reign of the Nazis in Germany, and to groups from Latin America and the Middle East, among others, during modern political times. In this book, I am not going to dwell upon all of the scientific information that has been gathered by anthropologists, biologists, geneticists, and other scientists concerning the fact that there are no such things as human biological races. This has been done by many people over the past 50 or so years. What I am going to do is to describe the history of our myth of race and racism. As I describe this history, I think that you will be able to understand why many of our leaders and their followers have deluded us into believing these racist fallacies, and how they have been perpetuated from the late Middle Ages to the present. Many of our basic policies of race and racism have been developed as a way to keep these leaders and their followers in control of the way we live our modern lives. These leaders often see themselves as the best and the brightest. Much of this history helped establish and maintain the Spanish Inquisition, colonial policies, slavery, Nazism, racial separatism and discrimination, and anti-immigration policies. Although policies related to racism seem to be improving over time, I hope to help clarify why this myth still exists and remains widespread in the United States and throughout Western Europe by describing the history of racism and by exploring how the anthropological concepts of culture and worldview have challenged and disproven the validity of racist views. Over the past 500 or so years, many intellectuals and their books have created our story of racism. They developed our initial ideas of race in Western society and solidified the attitudes and beliefs that gradually followed under the influence of their economic and political policies. Then, approximately 100 years ago, anthropologist Franz Boas came up with an alternate explanation for why peoples from different areas or living under certain conditions behave differently from one another. People have divergent life histories, different shared experiences, with distinctive ways of relating to these differences. We all have a worldview, and we all share our worldview with others with similar experiences. We have culture. It took many years for Boas and his few followers to develop this idea and pass it on to others. However, over the past 50 or 60 years, anthropologists, biologists, and geneticists have written many articles and books explaining why biological race in humans is non-existent. At first, scientists attempted to classify human races based on variations in characteristics such as skin color, hair color and form, eye color, facial anatomy, and blood groups. In the recent past, various scientists have divided us into anywhere between 3 and more than 30 different races without any success. Most of these hypothetical races were developed using assumptions about genetic relationships and distributions among different human populations. What is a race or subspecies? In 1942, Ashley Montague, a student of Franz Boas, claimed that there are no races. There are only what is now called clines. Traits considered to be racial are actually distributed independently and depend upon many environmental and behavioral factors. For the most part, each trait has a distinct distribution from other traits, and these traits are rarely determined by a single genetic factor. This type of distribution of a biological trait is referred to as a cline. For example, skin color is related to the amount of solar radiation, and dark skin is found in Africa, India, and Australia. However, many other genetic traits in people of these areas are not similar. Furthermore, similar traits, such as skin color, are convergent. Different genes can cause similar morphological and behavioral characteristics. For example, genetic pathways to dark skin are different in Tamil Nadu and in Nigeria. Genetic traits usually do not correlate with one another and are not distributed in the same place or in the same way over time. Race is supposed to tell us something about our genetic history. Who is related to whom? How did populations evolve over time, and how isolated were they in the past? Recent studies have shown us that humans have been migrating since Homo sapiens evolved some 200,000 years ago. This migration has not been in one direction, but happened back and forth. Our genes have been mixing since we evolved, and our genetic structure looks more like a complex intermixed trellis than a simple candelabra. It is very difficult to tell what our particular genetic background is over human historic time. We humans are more similar to each other as a group than we are to one another within any particular racial or genetic category. Many anthropological books have been written to explain this phenomenon. Our view of genetics has also changed in recent times. Although many people still believe that genes or a series of genes directly determine some of our most complex behavioral or cognitive characteristics, the reality is more complicated. Studies now show that each gene is only a single player in a wondrous, intricate drama involving non-additive interactions of genes, proteins, hormones, food, and life experiences and learning that interact to affect us on different levels of cognitive and behavioral functions. Each gene has an effect on multiple types of behaviors, and many behaviors are affected by many genes as well as other factors. The assumption that a single gene is causative can lead to unwarranted conclusions and an overinterpretation of any genuine genetic linkage. Before beginning this story, however, it is important to understand how scientists define the concept of race. How is race defined in biological terms? What do we mean by the term race when describing population variation in large mammals, such as humans? Do the criteria used in describing these variations hold when we examine human population variation? In biological terms, the concept of race is integrally bound to the process of evolution and the origin of species. It is part of the process of the formation of new species and is related to subspecific differentiation. However, because conditions can change and subspecies can and do merge, this process does not necessarily lead to the development of new species. In biology, a species is defined as a population of individuals who are able to mate and have viable offspring, that is, offspring who are also successful in reproducing. The formation of new species usually occurs slowly over a long period of time. For example, many species have a widespread geographic distribution with ranges that include ecologically diverse regions. If these regions are large in relationship to the average distance of migration of individuals within the species, there will be more mating, and thus more exchange of genes, within than between regions. Over very long periods of time, tens of thousands of years, differences would be expected to evolve between distant populations of the same species. Some of these variations would be related to adaptations to ecological differences within the geographic range of the populations, while others might be purely random. Over time, if little or no mating, or genetic exchange, occurs between these distant populations, genetic and related morphological differences will increase. Ultimately, over tens of thousands of years of separation, if little or no mating takes place between separate populations, genetic distinctions can become so great that individuals of the different populations could no longer mate and produce viable offspring. The two populations would now be considered two separate species. This is the process of speciation. However, again, none of these criteria require that speciation will ultimately occur. Since speciation develops very slowly, it is useful to recognize intermediate stages in this process. Populations of a species undergoing differentiation would show genetic and morphological variation due to a buildup of genetic differences, but would still be able to breed and have offspring that could successfully reproduce. They would be in the various stages of the process of speciation, but not yet different species. In biological terminology, it is these populations that are considered races or subspecies. Basically, subspecies within a species are geographically, morphologically, and genetically distinct populations, but still maintain the possibility of successful interbreeding. Thus, using this biological definition of race, we assume that races or subspecies are populations of a species that have genetic and morphological differences due to barriers to mating. Furthermore, little or no mating, or genetic exchange, between them has persisted for extremely long periods of time, thus giving the individuals within the population a common and separate evolutionary history. Given advances in molecular genetics, we now have the ability to examine populations of species and subspecies and reconstruct their evolutionary histories in an objective and explicit fashion. In this way, we can determine the validity of the traditional definition of human races by examining the patterns and amount of genetic diversity found within and among human populations, and by comparing this diversity with other large-bodied animals that have wide geographic distributions. In other words, we can determine how much populations of a species differ from one another and how these divergences came about. A commonly used method to quantify the amount of within-to-among group genetic diversity is through examining molecular data using statistics measuring genetic differences within and between populations of a species. Using this method, biologists have set a minimal threshold for the amount of genetic differentiation that is required to recognize subspecies. Compared to other large animals with wide geographic distributions, human populations do not reach this threshold. In fact, even though humans have the widest distribution, the measure of human genetic diversity, based on 16 populations from Europe, Africa, Asia, the Americas, and the Australia-Pacific region, falls well below the threshold used to recognize races for other species and is among the lowest value known for large mammalian species. This is true even if we compare humans to chimpanzees. Using a number of molecular markers, Templeton further has shown that the degree of isolation among human populations that would have been necessary for the formation of biological subspecies or races never occurred during the 200,000 years of modern human evolution. Combined genetic data reveal that from around 1 million years ago to the last tens of thousands of years, human evolution has been dominated by two evolutionary forces. One, constant population movement and range expansion, and two, restrictions on mating between individuals only because of distance. Thus, there is no evidence of fixed long-term geographic isolation between populations. Other than some rare temporary isolation events, such as the isolation of the Aborigines of Australia, for example, the major human populations have been interconnected by mating opportunities, and thus genetic mixture, during the last 200,000 years, as long as modern humans, Homo sapiens, have been around. As summarized by Templeton, who is among the world's most recognized and respected geneticists, because of the extensive evidence for genetic interchange through population movements and recurrent gene flow going back at least hundreds of thousands of years ago, there is only one evolutionary lineage of humanity, and there are no subspecies or races. Human evolution and population structure has been and is characterized by many locally differentiated populations coexisting at any given time, but with sufficient contact to make all of humanity a single lineage sharing a common long-term evolutionary fate. Thus, given current scientific data, biological races do not exist among modern humans today, and they have never existed in the past. Given such clear scientific evidence as this, and the research data of so many other biologists, anthropologists, and geneticists that demonstrate the non-existence of biological races among humans, how can the myth of human races still persist? If races do not exist as a biological reality, why do so many people still believe that they do? In fact, even though biological races do not exist, the concept of race obviously is still a reality, as is racism. These are prevalent and persistent elements of our everyday lives and generally accepted aspects of our culture. Thus, the concept of human races is real. It is not a biological reality, however, but a cultural one. Race is not a part of our biology, but it is definitely a part of our culture. Race and racism are deeply ingrained in our history. In this book, I use the term scientific racism to refer to scientists who continue to believe that race is a biological reality and categorize human races in a hierarchical fashion. Goals of this book. I began teaching courses in human evolution and human variation in the mid-1970s. In 1974, Richard Popkin, a philosopher, wrote a paper on the history of racism in Western Europe and the United States that focused on the period from the Spanish Inquisition of the 15th century to the 17th century. Popkin traced the germs of modern racism to two major themes or ideologies, the pre-Adamite and the degenerate views of human racial variation. Others also have recognized these two approaches to racist history and have used similar terms, or have substituted the terms polygenism and monogenism, respectively. Although Popkin did not extend his historical scenario to Darwin's time, the eugenics movement, Nazism, or current concepts and debates about race and racism, some of the basic underlying premises he described can be traced through the 19th and 20th centuries and still exist today. In this volume, I will review Popkin's original theme and show how some ancient perspectives on race have survived and persist in some current views on this topic. I am not a historian. What I have tried to do here is trace the ideas of monogenism and polygenism that continue to resurface through many sources, and to follow this common thread underlying the concept of race and the basis of racism from the 15th century to modern times. Furthermore, as I will show, this history of race and racism is a major component in the development of modern anthropology. I have not done a great deal of archival research myself, but instead have depended upon the published works of many historians, biographers, and philosophers who have painstakingly searched out many exchanges, letters, and difficult-to-locate original sources. I have tried to synthesize this literature and show how it all comes together into one story, a fairly consistent story, outlining the underpinnings of a 6-century-old racist ideology. Thus, I hope to illuminate why some of us are still living in the Middle Ages in terms of the subject of race. I will also explore why some very early views of race based on ignorance, emotion, hatred, intolerance, and prejudice have been repeated almost verbatim through the ages. They are still being voiced by modern racists, despite empirical data and growing scientific evidence through the centuries and decades that contradicts this racist ideology. As one result of this exploration, I hope that at least some of those caught in the past will understand why their intolerance is as baseless as the idea of a flat earth. For others, I hope that this book will further their understanding of why racism is still so prevalent in our society, why the anthropological concept of culture is so important and the influence of culture on our lives is so profound. Unfortunately, one's cultural background often trumps logic, empirical data, and modern science. In fact, modern science is by its very nature framed by culture. However, in the end, I hope to show that racism and bigotry are fueled by deep-seated hatred and intolerance of human variation and are not supported by empirical evidence or modern science. 1. Early racism in Western Europe. Early Christians, Hebrews, and the Greeks allowed outgroups to overcome their alleged inferiority by converting to the superior or dominant group, or through the process of assimilating. The Greeks, for example, allowed so-called barbarians to learn to speak, write, think, and live as Greeks. However, in the 15th century, the Spanish introduced a new form of racism. In order to squelch the large and rising number of Jews who had been forced to convert to Catholicism and who were gaining status financially and in the church, old Christians were separated from new Christians, or conversos, on biological grounds. Anyone with Jewish ancestry in the previous five generations was considered a new Christian and was subject to a number of restrictions, including an inability to attend college, join certain religious orders, or hold government positions. Certificates of purity of blood were issued to non-Jews to prove that an individual was not a member of this inferior group. The Spanish Inquisition. The Spanish Inquisition was established to ensure that those of Jewish ancestry were kept apart and out of the mainstream of society. Although it was mainly directed at Jews, the Inquisition also focused on Christianized Muslims and Gypsies, and later moved to Asia and America, where it targeted indigenous people. In Spain, the Inquisition was formally established in 1478, although it built on earlier Inquisitions in other places. When it moved to Rome in the 16th century, although still persecuting Jews, the Inquisition expanded its focus to include Protestants, homosexuals, people accused of witchcraft, free thinkers, public intellectuals, and people considered to be quirky or gadflies. The Inquisitions discriminated against and separated one group from another without allowing any legal means for the discriminated group to assimilate. Unlike earlier Inquisitions, the Spanish Inquisition did not focus on religion alone, but expanded to include ethnicity or race, introducing the notion of limpieza de sangre, or impurity of blood. It was about classes of people rather than just categories of belief, author Cullen Murphy notes. Furthermore, it was run by those in political power. It was political. Religion, ideology, and race or ethnicity were ruled and defined by the state. Minority or conquered peoples could not change their identities. They could not convert or assimilate into mainstream society. Although these discriminating practices began as a result of economic and political conditions, scientific theories justifying this kind of racism began to appear in Spain and Portugal in the 15th century, and after the discovery of America, they were expanded to justify similar racist ideas toward Native Americans, Asians, and later enslaved Africans. It is interesting to note that Columbus's voyage to America was at the peak of the Inquisition in Spain. It was financed mainly by conversos, and there were conversos among the ship's crews. In fact, a large number of Jews who had refused to be baptized were leaving Spain at that time. The initial cause of anti-Semitism in Spain and Portugal may have been jealousy of the power, wealth, and influence of some Jews and others in early Spanish society. However, it could also be explained and justified by biblical explanations of Jews as the killers of Christ and eternal enemies of Christianity. But when the Spaniards and Portuguese began to colonize America, The people they conquered and whose land they were taking had no established role in European society. Prior to this, travelers and explorers saw continuity between neighboring peoples as they traveled slowly through adjacent areas instead of traveling long distances to entirely new regions, basically jumping continents. New rationalizations had to be made to justify mistreating the peoples Europeans encountered, and new theories formed to explain their place in the universe. As described by Popkin, although numerous explanations were expounded, two major theories emerged, became prominent, and exhibited remarkable staying power: the pre-Adamite and the degenerate theories. These theories first centered on the question of whether Native Americans' origins were traceable to migrations of biblical people that had somehow become degenerate or were not descendants from the biblical world at all, but had a separate origin. In this latter theory, American Indians were not descendants of Adam and Eve, but had an independent earlier origin. They were pre-Adamites. The conquistadors justified their maltreatment of Native Americans by claiming they were subhuman and incapable of having abstract ideas and of running their own world. They were also deemed incapable of morality and unable to become Christian. These views were promulgated by Spanish theorists such as Sepúlveda and Oviedo in the early 16th century. In 1512, Montesinos, a preacher in Santo Domingo, opposed the mistreatment of the Indians and insisted that they were human. Bartolomé de las Casas, who became Bishop of Chiapas, became an advocate of this cause and debated Sepúlveda and his followers for almost half a century. He claimed that all people in the world are men, all have understanding and volition, all take satisfaction in goodness and feel pleasure with happy and delicious things, all regret and abhor evil. The first professor of philosophy in the New World, Alonso de la Vera Cruz, argued in his first and only course at the University of Mexico that Spaniards did not have the right to subjugate the Indians, and Pope Paul III in 1537 declared that the Indians are truly men and that they are not only capable of understanding the Catholic faith, but according to our information they desire exceedingly to receive it. However, the Church could not stop the conquest of America and the mistreatment of Native American peoples. Even though the Spanish government and the Church eventually declared that the Indians were fully human, Vera Cruz was removed as professor and sent to Lower Yucatan. The mistreatment of Native Americans did not subside. As the inhumane conquest of America continued, racial theories remained crucial in justifying the treatment of the local peoples, and, a bit later, the enslavement of Africans, who often were needed to replace the rapidly dying indigenous Americans as a workforce for exploiting the New World. The early Spanish debate was simply a preview of things to come. The two main theories used to explain human differences, pre-Adamite and degenerate, that the Spanish and Portuguese had first proposed in the 16th century, were later adopted mainly by the English, Anglo-Americans, and the French in the 17th and 18th centuries. These theories then provided the basis of racist thought in regard to people of color and Jews for the 19th and 20th centuries. In fact, I will argue that the threads of these two theories survived Darwinian times and the modern synthesis of evolutionary theory. Furthermore, they are still with us today, both in the general public and in Western science. The degeneration theory of race from ancient times to Darwin. Although the pre-Adamite or polygenic theory had a following throughout the period covered here and became the dominant theory in the mid-19th century, the degeneration theory of race was the most accepted version in earlier times. Rather than challenging the biblical account of human origins, a generally unpopular approach, The degeneration theory assumed that all humans were created by God, beginning with Adam and Eve. Non-whites were thought to be inferior and to need the guidance and control of rational, moral men, that is, white European Christians. Their condition was considered to be caused by some degenerative process that was related to climate or conditions of life, to isolation from Christian civilization, or to some divine action explained in the Bible. This was, in fact, the more liberal point of view, since proponents of this approach believed that these degenerates could be remediated by giving them the benefits of European education and culture, especially by missionizing them to Christianity. After the debates between the Church and the conquistadors discussed, one of the earliest well-known proponents of the degeneration theory was John Locke. Locke was the 17th-century architect of English colonial policy who drafted the Constitution for the Carolinas. He accepted the biblical account of human origins, but believed that the equality at creation and the endowment of natural rights to all humans no longer had to be applied, because the American Indians were not using their land properly. He also believed that they should lose their liberty because they had unjustly opposed the Europeans. Locke justified the maltreatment and slavery of non-whites based on what he considered their personal failures. In the 18th century, many of the early well-known natural historians attempted to explain just why these people were such failures. These degeneration theorists attempted to explain that the factors that led some peoples to change from white skin to dark involved ways of life that were far inferior to those of Europeans. The French nobleman, politician, and political philosopher of the Enlightenment, Montesquieu, Charles-Louis du Secondon, Baron de la Brède de Montesquieu, 1689 through 1755, was among the first to develop an elaborate climate theory in his De l'Esprit des Lois, 1748. He believed that climate and geography affected the temperaments and customs of a country's inhabitants, and thus accounted for differences among humans and their cultures. However, these differences were not hereditary, and if one moved from one climate to another, one's temperament would change. Carl Linnaeus, 1707 through 1778, the founder of modern biology and the person who developed the system of zoological classification of species still in use today, also believed in the unity of mankind. Linnaeus, the son of a Lutheran minister, was born in southern Sweden. He studied medicine and later in his life became a professor at the University of Uppsala. Medicine in those days was mainly a matter of herbal remedies, and Linnaeus became a specialist in botany. However, he continued to practice medicine and became the physician to the royal family. He also revitalized the Uppsala Botanical Garden. In fact, he considered himself God's registrar. His goal was to systematize the naming of all the plants and animals God had created and put them in order. The order so derived, however, was not based on relationship through evolution. It was a creationist concept. All species were created as fixed and separate species, whose perfect representations were to be found only in the mind of God. As anthropologist C. Loring Brace has stated, "The assumption that the world was hierarchically arranged pervaded medieval Christian thought and continued without question in the outlook of the Enlightenment thinkers as well. Linnaeus and his contemporaries simply took that general view and provided a more specific picture of all aspects of the world arranged in a series of steps running from God at the top down through the various entities of the living world to the inorganic. This arrangement was referred to as the Scala Naturae, or Great Chain of Being." Using this concept, Linnaeus published 12 editions of his famous Systema Naturae during his lifetime, and in the 10th edition, 1758, he established the system of binomial nomenclature in zoology, the starting point for all zoological nomenclature since. The first edition was published in 1735, before Linnaeus was 30 years old. He classified all living organisms into named units in descending order of increasing distinctiveness and began the two-name classification of genus and species for the basic name of an organism. Thus, he devised the term Homo sapiens for humans, and in fact considered all humans to be members of the same species. Based on anatomical similarity, he placed humans in the order primates, along with apes and monkeys, and bats. This made some of his contemporaries quite uneasy. Linnaeus then classified varieties of humans in relationship to their supposed education and climatic situation. As usual, those who did the classifying, white Europeans, were seen as the superior variety. As did Montesquieu, Linnaeus believed the differences were due to climate and social conditions. A contemporary of Linnaeus was the French naturalist Georges-Louis Leclerc, Comte de Buffon, 1707 through 1788. Buffon was perhaps the greatest naturalist of the 18th century. Independently wealthy, as were most scholars at that time, a fact that allowed them to take up their scholarly pursuits in the first place, Buffon moved from Burgundy to Paris in 1739, where he became the keeper of the Jardin du Roi, later to become the Jardin des Plantes, in which was housed the Paris Zoo and the Muséum National d'Histoire Naturelle. Buffon died at the age of 80, 1 year and 3 months before the beginning of the French Revolution. Since he had worked for King Louis XVI and had been in his favor, he was made a count in 1771, Buffon was not well treated after his death. His coffin was dug up, his remains were scattered, and his monument was smashed. Worst of all, his only son was sent to the guillotine a few years later. It is quite amazing that Bernard Germain de Lesepède and Louis-Jean-Marie Daubenton, protégés, co-authors, and close colleagues of Buffon, survived the French Revolution and were instrumental in the appointment of two key members of the next generation of French scholars, Étienne Geoffroy Saint-Hilaire, 1772 through 1844, and Georges Cuvier, 1769 through 1832, who became dominant figures in the study of natural history just before the publication of Charles Darwin's On the Origin of Species. This story is nicely told in Groves. Buffon offered the most complete explanation of human variation of his time in the fourth and fifth volumes of his 43-volume Histoire Naturelle, written from 1785 to 1787. Humans are not composed of essentially different species among themselves, but on the contrary, there is only one sole species of man which has multiplied and covered all the surfaces of the earth and has been subjected to different changes due to influences of the climate, differences in nutrition, and those of manner of life, lifestyle, by sicknesses, epidemics, and also by the various infinite mixture of individuals more or less similar. As one moves away from Central Europe, Buffon explains, these various factors cause increasing degeneration from the ideal original humans. The best climate is found between 40 and 50 degrees. It is here that one finds the most beautiful and most fit humans. It is in this climate that one finds the ideal of the natural color of man. It is here where one finds the model or the origin from which is derived all of the other nuances of color or of beauty. The two extremes are equally far from the true ideal and the beautiful. The countries situated in this zone are Georgia, Circassia, Ukraine, Turkey, Europe, Hungary, Germany, Italy, Switzerland, France, and parts of Spain. All these people are also the most beautiful and the best fit of all the earth. Although the views of Linnaeus and Buffon might seem similar to us today, their approaches were actually quite different, and they were intellectual rivals throughout their years. Linnaeus was interested mainly in naming the categories of animals, and his task would be complete when all organisms in creation had been classified. The nested hierarchy of life he created in his classification scheme, however, did not imply any particular process. Buffon, on the other hand, was an enemy of all rigid classification and believed that the categories devised by Linnaeus were simply human creations. He stated, "In fact, in nature there are only individuals. Genera, orders, and classes exist only in our imaginations." Buffon was more interested in process. He seemed to be aware of what we would call ecology and adaptation, and noted the relationships among the forms of plants and animals and certain aspects of the environment in the regions in which they lived. Throughout his writings, there was a continual concern for the processes by which organic form is shaped that was completely missing in the writings of Linnaeus, Brace noted. It is ironic that Buffon formulated an early scientific version of evolution, but rejected it. In fact, he rejected Linnaeus's system of higher taxonomic categories because he thought they implied something insidious, that is, microevolution, and this was against his religious beliefs. Jonathan Marks notes, "Even though Linnaeus himself did not espouse such an idea, it was, according to Buffon, simply because he had not grasped sufficiently the full scope of the implications of his system." Buffon regarded Linnaeus as a nomenclateur rather than what we would now refer to as a scientist. The German physician and anatomist Johann Friedrich Blumenbach, 1752 through 1840, often thought of as the father of physical anthropology, was a disciple of Linnaeus and idolized him. However, Blumenbach was also interested in process. Like Linnaeus and Buffon, he was a monogenicist who believed that all humans were created by God. In his dissertation, which he wrote at the age of 23 in 1775, a year before the American Revolution, he attempted to classify the varieties of humans and to explain the significance of their physical and mental differences. As did Linnaeus and Buffon, he believed that all humans were the same species. He also insisted that there were no sharp distinctions between groups and that supposed racial characteristics graded continuously from one people to another. He was among the first to refer to race, but believed that divisions of human groups were somewhat arbitrary and were used for the convenience of the classifier. Following Buffon, in 1775, Johann Friedrich Blumenbach published the first edition of his dissertation, De Generis Humani Varietate Nativa, on the natural variety of mankind, in which he stated that he had constructed his human racial classification simply as a matter of convenience. This book became a standard beginning reference point for discussions about human races. In a greatly expanded third edition, written in 1795, when Blumenbach was serving as a professor of medicine at the University of Göttingen, he wrote, "Although there seems to be so great a difference between widely separate nations that you might easily take the inhabitants of different regions for so many different species of man, yet when the matter is thoroughly considered, you see that all do so run into one another, and that one variety of mankind does so sensibly into the other, that you cannot mark out the limits between them. Very arbitrary indeed, both in number and definition, have been the varieties of mankind accepted by eminent men." Blumenbach went on to specify first four, based on Linnaeus's four geographically noted varieties, and later five varieties of humans associated with major regions of the world. His five varieties, Caucasian, Mongoloid, Ethiopian, American, and Malay, became widely accepted by the educated community, and with some slight variations they are still in use today. First, he coined the term Caucasian to refer to people of European descent, and in doing so defined them as the most beautiful, the closest to representing God's image, and the original humans from which other varieties had degenerated. Was this done by any scientific means? Well, no. He developed this on purely aesthetic grounds, and of course on his own views of aesthetics. Blumenbach's descriptions are pervaded by his personal sense of relative beauty, presented as though he were discussing an objective and quantifiable property not subject to doubt or disagreement. Second, even though he had expressed the difficulty of drawing lines between varieties of humans, he accepted the underlying paradigm of the day, as had Linnaeus, Cuvier, and Buffon, that one variety was indeed better and preferable to another in relationship to God's original creation. In fact, unlike Linnaeus and Buffon, his varieties were set up not simply in a geographical system, but also in a hierarchical one. Cuvier, before him, had described three varieties of human species and maintained that the Mongolian race remained stationary with regard to civilization and that the black race had never progressed beyond utter barbarism. Blumenbach, with his five varieties of humans, set up a racial geometry with two lines degenerating through intermediary stages from a central Caucasian ideal. Stephen Jay Gould believed that Blumenbach's hierarchical model of human races was a major factor in the creation of the modern racist's paradigm, the shift from a geographic to a hierarchical ordering of human diversity marks a fateful transition in the history of Western science. For what, short of railroads and nuclear bombs, had more practical impact, in this case almost entirely negative, upon our collective lives and nationalities? Ironically, J.F. Blumenbach is the focus of this shift, for his five-race scheme became canonical, and he changed the geometry of human order from Linnaean cartography to linear ranking by putative worth. Gould believed this ironic, because although many of the monogenesists were opposed to slavery and the mistreatment of the degenerated varieties of mankind, and believed they could be regenerated in one way or another, Blumenbach was among the least racist and one of the most egalitarian of the Enlightenment scholars. In fact, he had a library in his home devoted to the writings of black authors and praised the faculties of these our black brethren, most likely as a rebuttal to the more common, pervasive Humean and Kantian mentality. He campaigned for the abolition of slavery, a view not popular in his day, and interestingly asserted the moral superiority of slaves to their captors. Nevertheless, in the end, Blumenbach ended up with a system with one single race, Caucasian, at the top. He assumed that race to represent the closest to original creation, and then envisioned two lines of departure from this ideal toward greater and greater degeneration. As Brace emphasized, "For the next two centuries, those who have attempted to classify human biological variation have inevitably built on the scheme proposed by Blumenbach." Inherent in the degeneration theory of race was the concept of change. This was, however, a difficult idea to deal with in the 18th and 19th centuries because of the basically accepted tenet of the fixity of species as originally created by God. Yet many of the proponents of this theory attempted to explain how degeneration actually had occurred. Buffon noted the relationship between aspects of the environment of particular regions and the forms of plants and animals living there. He accepted the idea that the similarity among differently adapted forms in given regions suggested some kind of adaptive relationship, and although he rejected the idea of organic evolution and went on at length to debunk any such theory, he brought it up as a topic of discussion. He was concerned with the processes by which organic forms developed, and believed that environmental conditions could cause populations to change within a species, but certainly not enough to become another species altogether. Similarly, Blumenbach, in writing about human varieties, believed that the farther populations had migrated from their place of origin in the Caucasus, the more they were affected by different environments and conditions of life. Factors that could cause these changes were climate, nutrition, and mode of life. Over many generations, differences in these factors led to changes, degenerations, in form from the original. Cuvier expounded the idea of catastrophism. He believed that the Earth went through a series of invoked catastrophes at the boundaries between geological strata, and that new species were created after each of these catastrophes, presumably by divine creation. Cuvier, however, like Linnaeus, was concerned more with the patterns that had been created by God than with the process by which patterns developed. The most logical concept of the process of biological change at the time, given the available evidence, was that formulated by Jean-Baptiste Lamarck. Born in the north of France, Lamarck was the youngest of 11 children in an impoverished noble family with a centuries-old tradition of military service. His father and several of his brothers were soldiers. He entered a Jesuit seminary around 1756, but after his father's death in 1761, he bought an old horse and rode off to join the French army. He fought in the Seven Years' War in Germany, and at the age of 17, distinguished himself for bravery under fire and was commissioned as a lieutenant. In 1766, because of an injury, Lamarck was forced to retire to Paris with a meager pension. There, close to poverty, he supported himself as a bank clerk and began to study medicine. Then, possibly influenced by his friend Jean-Jacques Rousseau, he dropped medicine for the study of botany. In 1778, he published a book on the botany of France, and this launched his career in science. Buffon was impressed by Lamarck and engaged him as a tutor for his son, the one who later went to the gallows, and was instrumental in getting him admitted to the Academy of Sciences. In 1781, Buffon had Lamarck appointed as royal botanist and collector for the Jardin du Roi, and they traveled together collecting plants for the garden in Germany, Holland, and Hungary. Lamarck held this position until 1793. In that year, Louis XVI and Marie Antoinette were sent to the guillotine, and the renamed Jardin des Plantes was reorganized as the Muséum National d'Histoire Naturelle. It was to be run by 12 professors of different scientific specialties. Lamarck was appointed as one of those professors, the one in charge of the natural history of insects or worms and microscopic animals. Invertebrates, a term Lamarck later coined. This was the least prestigious of the professorships, and a subject about which Lamarck knew nothing. To his credit, Lamarck took on the enormous challenges of organizing the museum's vast and growing collections and of learning and creating a new field of biology. Lamarck published a series of books on invertebrate zoology and paleontology. He also published in the fields of physics, meteorology, and hydrogeology. Lamarck is most remembered, and often most criticized, however, for his early theories of evolution, which are most clearly stated in his Philosophie zoologique, 1809. Lamarck expounded the idea that organisms are not passively altered by the environment, but that environmental changes cause changes in the needs of organisms that in turn cause changes in their behavior. This altered behavior leads to greater or lesser use of a given structure or organ. Thus, use causes increase in size of the structure or organ, and disuse causes it to decrease in size or disappear over several generations. This was Lamarck's first law, that use or disuse causes structures to enlarge or shrink. His second law was that all such changes were heritable. Lamarck believed in continuous, gradual change of all organisms as they become adapted to their environment. One aspect of Lamarck's theory of evolution that differs markedly from modern Darwinian evolutionary theory is that evolution is not driven by chance. He believed instead that in evolution, nature is attempting to produce in succession, in every species of animal, a form beginning with the least perfect or simplest to an end product of the most perfect and structurally complex. He posed a specific direction, perfection, to be reached in every lineage, a progressive development in nature. In this way, Lamarck was attempting to describe a particular process by which change takes place. At the time it was written, this idea was too radical for those who believed in the concept of the fixity of species as created by God. Lamarck was ridiculed for these ideas by his contemporaries and even by his closest colleagues, Buffon and Cuvier. Lamarck struggled with poverty throughout his life. He was married 4 times and had 7 children. He spent his last years totally blind and cared for by 2 of his devoted daughters. When he died in 1829, he received a poor man's funeral and was buried in a rented grave. His books and the contents of his home were sold at auction. 5 years later, his body was removed, and no one knows the final location of his remains. His friend, Geoffroy Saint-Hilaire, gave one of the orations at his funeral. 2 years after Lamarck's death, Cuvier used the form of a eulogy to discredit Lamarck's scientific beliefs, depicting his theories as able to entertain poets, but unable to support the examination of any scientist. Since Cuvier was so respected in his day, his remarks on Lamarck's views of evolution helped banish them to obscurity at that time. However, by the middle of the 19th century, since even the theory of degeneration implied the process of change, many scientists began to develop different views of how changes in biology and social phenomena occur. At that point, Lamarck's theories became acceptable to many of the biologists and social scientists. In fact, at the time of Darwin's Origins, Lamarckism had become one of the few scientific theories of degeneration theorists presenting a coherent explanation of how environment could influence biological and social change. Lamarck was acknowledged as a great zoologist and as a forerunner of the theory of evolution by many of the scientists and evolutionists of Darwin's time, including Darwin, Charles Lyell, Ernest Haeckel, Paul Broca, and the American paleontologist Edward Drinker Cope. In fact, Darwin incorporated Lamarckian explanations in some of his descriptions of the process of change. Lamarck's view of transformation could be seen as the beginning of modern zoology. Darwin wrote, "Lamarck was the first man whose conclusions on the subject excited much attention. This justly celebrated naturalist first published his views in 1801. He first did the eminent service of arousing attention to the probability of all change in the organic, as well as in the inorganic world, being the result of law and not of miraculous interposition." This view of how acquired characteristics could influence change was epitomized in a book written by Richard Lewis Dugdale in 1877, with new editions appearing until 1910, entitled The Jukes, A Study in Crime, Pauperism, Disease, and Heredity. Dugdale described the history and experiences of the Juke family over many generations. In carefully examining the influence of environment on various members of the same family, actually a compilation of over 40 families, Dugdale pointed out the improvement in delinquent behavior that could be brought about by a change in environment. As a believer in the theory of acquired characteristics, Dugdale stated, "Where the environment changes in youth, the characteristics of heredity may measurably be altered, hence the importance of education." To Dugdale, like other degeneration theorists, Lamarckism worked both ways. Environment tends to produce habits which may become hereditary if it should be sufficiently constant to produce modification of cerebral tissue. From the above considerations, the logical induction seems to be that environment is the ultimate controlling factor in determining careers, placing heredity itself as an organized result of invariable environment. In sum, he argued, heredity fixes the organic characteristics of the individual, while environment affects modifications in that heredity. Many scientists of the time believed that Lamarckian theory meant that environment was a very important factor in producing human behavioral characteristics. Since Darwin did not provide any single coherent explanation of the processes of biological change in his theory of natural selection, Lamarckism's acquired characteristics could be included as one of many possible processes. In fact, many of Darwin's explanations are quite Lamarckian, his theory of pangenesis, for example. However, with the rediscovery of Mendelian genetics and with the experiments of August Weismann around the turn of the century, Lamarckian theory once again was debunked and ridiculed. The pre-Adamite polygenic theory from the 16th century to Darwin. The pre-Adamite or polygenic theory of human variation existed alongside the degenerate theory, and often in direct contrast to it, from the 16th century to Darwin's times. Early views that inhabitants of the New World were not descended from the biblical Adam were provided by Paracelsus, 1493 to 1541, who lectured on medicine at the University of Basel and is credited with establishing the importance of chemistry in medicine. He was a controversial figure who was not reluctant to contradict the traditional view of a single creation of man. In the early 16th century, he argued that people in faraway places were from a different source, the same one that had produced nymphs, sirens, griffins, and salamanders, all examples of beings without souls. Later in that century, the philosopher and cosmologist Giordano Bruno claimed that the Indians, Ethiopians, pygmies, giants, and other strange and far-off beings were not descended from the same progenitor as the rest of the human world. Bruno was burned at the stake in Rome in 1600, a victim of the Inquisition. The polygenic theory that was the most influential in racist ideology and had the most staying power was the pre-Adamite theory of Isaac Laperere, 1596 through 1676. Laperere, a French Calvinist from a family of Spanish Jews who had been expelled from Spain at the end of the 15th century, had a long and eventful life. He was the first to propose this theory in his work Pre-Adamate, which was written in 1641 and published in Amsterdam in 1655. It was translated into English in 1656 as a theological system upon that presupposition that men were before Adam. Popkin gives a detailed synopsis of Laperere's theory. I will only point out salient features here. Laperere argued that there were millions of people prior to Adam, but that they lived in a miserable state. Then God created Adam and began Jewish history in order to save mankind. His book challenged the authenticity of the Bible and was burned and banned. Laperere was considered a heretic. His views were condemned and he was imprisoned for 6 months. When he was released, he was forced to write a formal retraction. Popkin states, "Although his work was constantly being refuted from 1655 onward, its polygenic thesis kept being revived as the best explanation of the new findings in geology, biology, archaeology, anthropology, and history that conflicted with the Bible." The racist implications of the pre-Adamite theory began to reemerge during the Enlightenment among theorists who no longer took the Bible literally. By the 19th and early 20th centuries, it had transformed somewhat and developed into a powerful scientific defense of racist ideology. In the 18th century, the pre-Adamite or polygenic theory was less popular than the monogenic or degeneration theory because of the latter's closer adherence to the biblical account of human origins. However, although the polygenic theory was not the most popular view, it was still held as a minority viewpoint. David Hume, the renowned 18th-century Scottish philosopher, economist, and historian, was among the first noted authors to profess the polygenic theory of racism. He did so as part of his inductive naturalistic philosophy, or experimental philosophy. The only solid foundation we can give to this science, science of man, must be laid on experience and observation, he wrote in his Treatise of Human Nature. Hume, who is considered among the most important figures in the history of Western philosophy and the Scottish Enlightenment, advocated the separate creation and innate inferiority of non-white peoples. In the mid-1700s, Hume wrote, "I am apt to suspect the Negroes and in general all the other species of men, for there are four or five different kinds, to be naturally inferior to the whites. There never was a civilized nation of any other complexion than white, nor even any individual eminent either in action or speculation. No ingenious manufacturers among them, no arts, no sciences." In this statement, Hume was applying his methodology of historical inductive reasoning. Human nature was best studied by observations of human historical behavior, and from the European point of view, civilization had never existed outside of Europe. Following in Hume's footsteps, but adding and enveloping similar racist ideas into a whole system of philosophical thought, Immanuel Kant essentially created a racist anthropology based on skin color. A contemporary of Linnaeus's, Kant developed his own classification of human races. Kant is acknowledged as one of the most influential philosophers of the Enlightenment. In fact, he is widely thought of as the most important moral theorist of modern times. However, he also can be considered the father of the modern concepts of race and scientific racism. Kant, who introduced the term anthropology to German science and philosophy, was the founder of what might be considered racist anthropology, which dominated much of anthropology up until World War II. His classification of humans included four races based on color and climate. Kant believed that all races of man were created by God, but that the characteristics, germs, of each were dependent upon climate. This made his polygenic view more acceptable to biblical interpretations of humanity. Climate determined the natural dispositions or character of each race, and once the progress toward each racial disposition had begun, it was irreversible. Existing races and racial characteristics could not be undone by changes in climate or circumstance, for once a race like the present one has been founded through long sojourn of its original stock, it could not be changed into another race by any further influences of the climate. For only the stem foundation can expatiate into a race, but once the latter has taken root and has stifled the other germs, it resists all further remodeling because the character of the race has now become predominant in the generative power. Kant's theory of race corresponded to intellectual ability and limitation. He included the typical color-coded races of Europe, Asia, Africa, and Native America, differentiated by their degree of innate talent. In Kant's theory, the nature of the white race guarantees its rational and moral order, and they are in the highest position of all creatures, followed by yellow, black, and then red. Non-whites do not have the capacity to realize reason and rational moral perfectibility through education. To Kant, color is evidence of unchanging and unchangeable moral quality and thus ultimately of free will. White Europeans have the necessary talent to be morally self-educating. Asians have some ability to do so, but lack the ability to develop abstract concepts. Innately idle Africans can only be educated as servants, to follow orders, but must be kept in order by severe punishment. And he explains how to properly beat them with split bamboo canes. Native Americans are hopeless and cannot be educated at all. Furthermore, mixing of races should be avoided because it causes misfortune and damage. Although Kant was a champion of the equality of all men and of civil rights, These were only for humans who have the ability to educate themselves and thus have free will. They were only for whites. Full personhood was actually dependent upon one's race. Non-whites were relegated to a lower rung in the moral ladder. Easy summarizes, "The black person, for example, can accordingly be denied full humanity, since full and true humanity accrues only to the white European." Kant believed that to be human, one must be able to think moral thoughts, reason, and have the ability, free will, to carry them out. Native Americans and blacks did not have these qualities, and thus could not be considered fully human. As the philosopher E.C. Easy notes, for Kant, the ideal skin color is white, the white brunette, and the others are superior or inferior as they approximate whiteness. To Kant, non-whites counted as sub-persons who were of considerably less value than whites because they were non-moral agents. Furthermore, non-moral agents lacked moral worth and became mere objects to be used as means to the ends of others. They were nothing but irrational animals whom superior moral agents, true humans, could master and rule at will. As with his contemporaries, Kant's theories were based on travelers' tales and on his own personal opinions. Rephrasing Hume directly, Kant stated, "The Negroes of Africa have by nature no feeling that rises above the trifling. Mr. Hume challenges anyone to cite a single example in which a Negro has shown talents, and asserts that hundreds of thousands of blacks who have been transported elsewhere from their countries, although many of them have been set free, still not one was ever found who presented anything great in art or science or any other praiseworthy quality. So fundamental is the difference between these two races of man, and it appears to be as great in regard to mental capacities as in color." Kant also generalized his depiction of non-personhood to Jews. Motives could be good or moral only if they were not motivated by a desire for material benefit, and he saw Judaism as an inherently materialist religion. He equated the Jewish religion with such undesirable traits as superstition, dishonesty, worldliness, and cowardliness. Of course, Kant's views on non-whites and on Jews were not original. They supported already existing, long and widely held stereotypes of Western and Christian thought. The United Jewish Appeal of Toronto points out that, "Going back to at least the 12th century, European culture had developed a rich and ghastly tableau of imaginary Jews. Kant's division of humanity reiterated and reinvigorated the religious and racial hierarchies of the past." He took this earlier religious hostility toward Jews and reformulated it in philosophical language. Kant set the stage for modern secular anti-Semitism and provided the framework for future anti-Semites, notably G.W.F. Hegel and the musician Richard Wagner. Since Wagner was a cultural hero for Adolf Hitler, Kant's own anti-Semitism can be seen as having a far-reaching effect. Kant taught a combination of physical geography and anthropology courses for 40 years, 1756 through 1797, introducing a scientific concept of race and a particular brand of physical racial anthropology, first in Germany, then in Europe and the United States. Kant had an exalted reputation. There was great respect for his work, and his writings were widely circulated. As the anthropologist Nina Jablonski stated, "Through his writings and lectures, Kant successfully instilled some of the most trenchant and potent classifications of humanity into the minds of inexperienced and unsophisticated readers and students." He became one of the most influential racists of all times, and his racial philosophy was passed on for centuries. Because Kant is widely thought of as the most important moral theorist of modern times and the father of modern moral theory, his theories on race have, until recently, been essentially ignored in discussions of the history of racism. However, as Jablonski states, "In the history of humanity, Few intellectual constructs have carried so much weight and produced such a river of human suffering. As philosopher Charles W. Mills summarized, the embarrassing fact for the White West, which doubtless explains its concealment, is that their most important moral theorist of the past 300 years is also the foundational theorist in the modern period of the division between Herrenvolk and Untermenschen, persons and subpersons, upon which Nazi theory would later draw. Modern moral theory and modern racial theory have the same father. The moral contract Kant and his colleagues developed is underlain first by a racial or color contract. It only applies to those of the white hue. Furthermore, as Matthew Hatchey emphasized, not only is it the case that the image of Kant passed on to succeeding generations of philosophers is one excessively sanitized, but it also seems reasonable at this point to infer that this selective memory is simply too extensive to be the result of mere accident or chance. Rather, it appears to be the result of a tradition conveniently blind to its own racism. By the end of the 18th century, as the controversy about slavery and the place of the Negro in nature and society heated up, Charles White, an English physician, again focused on the question of whether black Africans were products of the same act of creation as whites in An Account of the Regular Gradation in Man. He denounced the views of the degeneration theorists. White proposed that black Africans were inferior both physically and intellectually, and were an intermediate form between true humans, white Europeans, and apes, with other races intermediate between these extremes. Each race was seen as a separate species, the product of separate creation that was adapted for a particular geographic region. Although others had expounded this view, White's rendition was considered to be the most scientific. As we shall see in Chapter 6, a theory very similar to this one, in which the great apes are invoked to explain the differences among the races, surfaced again in the early 1900s. In the early 1800s, in Europe and America, there was a revival of Isaac Le Parer's pre-Adamite theory and continued attempts to reconcile it with the Bible. As described in detail by Popkin, Gould, and Brace, the 19th-century scientific version of the pre-Adamite theory was developed by the American Dr. Samuel Morton, 1799 through 1851, an accomplished eclectic physician and paleontologist, and his disciples, who became known as the Mortonites. Morton is well known for his technique of measuring the cranial capacity of human skulls by filling them with pepper seeds. His research, which compared different human groups, was published in two volumes, Crania Americana, 1839, and Crania Egyptiaca, 1844. Morton and his followers, George R. Glidden, Josiah Nott, and Louis Agassiz, reformulated or resurrected a powerful case for pre-Adamism. Their argument went as follows. 1. The cranial sizes and characteristics of various human racial groups were fixed and remained the same throughout recorded history, at least 3,000 years, as could be seen by skull measurements and Egyptian artwork. 2. The fixed cranial traits included a progressive decrease in cranial capacity from whites to Asians to Native Americans to African blacks. 3. These fixed differences did not fit biblical chronology, and therefore the best explanation was a separate creation of the different types of mankind. Brace believes that Morton was the founder of what is often called the American School of Anthropology, and that he was a true scholar and a careful and innovative scientist, and that he has been forgotten because his legacy was carried on in the hands of his followers, who forwarded the cause of slavery and racism. However, Morton, like his followers, strongly professed the inferiority of other races over white Europeans. When he died in 1851, his obituary in the Charleston Medical Journal read, "We of the South should consider him as our benefactor, for aiding most materially in giving to the Negro his true position as an inferior race. We believe the time is not far distant when it will be universally admitted that neither can the leopard change his spots, nor the Ethiopian his skin. Morton died before Origin of Species was published. However, Morton's followers bring us right up to Darwin's then-controversial volume. Josiah Nott, 1804 through 1873, became the main spokesman for the American School of Anthropology. He was a highly respected physician and surgeon from a prominent Southern family. His father was a lawyer who graduated from Yale, served one term in Congress, and then became a judge and the president of the South Carolina Court of Appeals. Josiah first practiced medicine in South Carolina and then followed his wife's family to Mobile, Alabama. He married the daughter of a wealthy Southern plantation owner. He was brought up on the coast of South Carolina, the region where the largest number of slaves in the world lived, and shared the racist attitudes of the South in the era just before the Civil War. His biographer stated, "As a Southern gentleman, not expected to be believed, though he had raised his innate prejudices to the level of what he assumed to be scientific truth." Although he claimed to be a scientific realist, Knott's writings on race between 1843 and the outbreak of the Civil War in 1861 and again in 1866 were colored by arrogant racist prejudice. Knott gave two lectures in 1843-1844 that he called his Lectures on Niggerology, and subsequently published in 1844 as a pamphlet entitled Two Lectures on the Natural History of the Caucasian and Negro Races. In these, he claimed there were several species of man that differed in the perfection of their moral and intellectual endowments. Knott claimed he was separating the actual history of mankind from the biblical account by showing that the Bible dealt with the creation and development of the Adamites, the Caucasians, and not with that of the pre-Adamites, the rest of mankind. Morton and Knott corresponded regularly after Morton read Knott's published lectures with pleasure and instruction. In 1847, Knott wrote to Morton, exclaiming, "My niggerology, so far from harming me at home, has made me a greater man than I ever expected to be. I am the big gun of the profession here." In 1850, Knott's views on polygenics were read at the annual meetings of the American Association for the Advancement of Science, AAAS, in Charleston, South Carolina, again with the backing of Morton. Indeed, he came to be regarded as one of the main articulators of Southern views on race in the period leading up to the Civil War and after. Louis Agassiz, 1807 through 1873, added international scientific credence and respectability to this group of pre-Adamites. Agassiz, son of a Protestant minister in French Switzerland, was a zoologist, paleontologist, and geologist, and a disciple of Cuvier. He was most known for his work on fossil fish. Until his death, he was an anti-Darwinist. He believed in the teleologically egocentric stance of traditional Christianity, which regarded human beings as the object and end of divine creation, and assumed that the world and its contents had been put there specifically to be exploited for human use. After he experienced some financial difficulties in Europe related to financing his own publications, not unusual at that time, Agassiz came to the United States in 1846. In fact, he came to the United States as a public scientific lecturer in order to rid himself of debt. Soon after arriving in America, Agassiz visited Morton in Philadelphia. Morton was to become an influence on him, second only to Cuvier. At the hotel where he was staying, he was served by the first black African he had ever encountered. Having been brought up in lily-white Switzerland and France, he was shocked by his first view of human variation. Shortly thereafter, Agassiz wrote a letter to his mother describing his repulsion at seeing someone so different from himself and the people he was used to seeing in white upper-class Europe. This emotional reaction was to influence his scientific views for the remainder of his life. At this point, he joined Morton and Knott in their views that different types of humans were separate species, not created from Adam, and that mixture between these species was leading to biological and intellectual inferiority. Agassiz's first American lectures were delivered in Boston in 1846 and were very successful. In fact, as a result of these lectures, he was offered and accepted a professorship of zoology and geology and directorship of the Lawrence Scientific School at Harvard. He remained in the United States for the rest of his life. In 1859, the Harvard Museum of Comparative Zoology was built for Agassiz with the hope that he and this museum would serve as an antidote to the threat of Darwinism. In 1850, at the AAAS meetings in Charleston, Agassiz, who had just been elected as the association's president, heard Knott's paper declaring that people of African descent were innately inferior to Europeans. He rose after the reading of Knott's paper to declare his support of Knott's polygenic position. Soon after that, Knott wrote to Morton, "With Agassiz in the war, the battle is ours. We shall not only have his name, but the timid will come out of their hiding places." In the same year, Agassiz wrote an essay in the Christian Examiner and Religious Miscellany entitled "The Diversity of Origins of the Human Races." Although he insisted that he was dealing with scientific matters and not politics, he wrote, "It seems to us to be mock philanthropy and mock philosophy to assume that all races have the same abilities, enjoy the same powers, and show the same natural dispositions, and that in consequence of this equality are entitled to the same position in human society. History speaks for itself." Furthermore, Agassiz asserted that the Bible never meant to say that all men originated from a single pair, Adam and Eve, nor that the animals had a similar origin from one common center or from a single pair. In the Bible, there is nowhere any mention of these physical differences characteristic of the colored races of men, such as the Mongolians and Negroes. Have we not, on the contrary, the distinct assertion that the Ethiopian cannot change his skin nor the leopard his spots? Agassiz's basic view was that all humans were created different.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.